Article 19(2), the restrictions on reasonable restrictions on the freedom of speech. He said, Munshi, in December 1, 1948, during the discussion, in a very prophetic ring, says, I quote, 150 years ago in England, holding a meeting or conducting a procession was considered sedition. Even holding an opinion against which will bring ill will towards government was considered sedition once. This is Munshi speaking in 1948 about England in 1800. As an aside, one can say that a look at the events that have been recently unfolding in front of us show that India in 2016 is actually not very different from England in 1800, right? So we see that people have been criminalized, you know, even locked, imprisoned for holding meetings or speaking in public meetings and so on. Now, the last point I wanted to highlight on was actually, again, the speaker before me did mention about this, the rights of a disabled person. I mean, as we know, the prison life for an able-bodied person itself is torturous. Now, what happens for a 90% disabled person who is incarcerated under a law like UAPA? And I think this is where we really see that there is a kind of lacuna in the debate. There isn't hardly, I mean, there is very few, debate or activity that's going on. There seems to be a total silence on the rights of the disabled as a prisoner. Doesn't a 90% disabled convicted under UAPA have the right to life, which means right to dignity and bodily integrity? I think Vasanta narrated the kind of the inhuman kind of treatment that Sai Baba is undergoing in the prison. As I have claimed elsewhere, our activism seems to have inherited the hierarchy of rights envisaged in the Constitution in terms of rights available to human beings qua person, as in the case of Articles 14 and 21, and qua citizen, as in the case of Articles 15, 16, and 19. So there seems to be a right conflict between the right, a fundamental right of a person and the fundamental right of a citizen. Now, fundamental right of citizen, like freedom of speech and expression, I think we get much more attention and discussion than the the basic ability to live as a human being. Because basically, I would say the people who raise these concerns are also people who have already become humans, whereas there are Dalits, Muslims, and many others who are still struggling, or disabled persons who are still struggling to live a life as a human being. And that is where I think quite often our activism is lacking behind. And the case of Sai Baba, I think, is an apt case to open some of these discussions. Sai Baba's case is also compounded with multiple ailments that he's suffering from. There are detailed discussions of his ailments. And denial of proper health care. So I think the way forward will be to not just to hold such discussions, which is important, but also like take this forward and, you know, build public opinion, write articles, maybe campaign for the awareness of not just Sai Baba. As Hargobal said, Sai Baba's fight is not for himself. And when we fight for Sai Baba, we are not fighting for Sai Baba alone. We are fighting for all of us.
Thank you, Professor Babu. I hope you'll excuse me raising another question for your consideration, which is this. Why do we need in the Indian legal system specialized laws? That is my very simple question to you. If an offense, which is a terrorist offense, is also covered under the IPC as waging war against the state, as murder, arson, whatever, if this section is also covered under sedition, let's say 153A, 124, my question is, why do we need special laws if there are punishments that are fully available under the IPC? And I think the answer that is staring us in the face is that the state enacts special laws only for the purpose of taking away the rights of the accused. And these rights are essentially procedural rights. So you have under the UAPA an elongated period of custody, which you do not get under the CRPC. You might have under the Tada and Pota admissibility of confessions, which you don't get under the Indian Evidence Act. And that is precisely and the sole reason why you have special laws in the armory of the state, which they deploy in cases such as this. I would like to thank all the panelists for coming today, taking out time and speaking to all of us. We have some time for questions, so please, if anyone has any questions for any of these panelists, please go ahead.
Taking cue from the kind of torture that Ms. Professor Sai Baba is facing in the prison. But we also have to consider that even if a person is specially abled, if he commits a crime, he still will be punished. So given the current infrastructure of our prisons, what alternate punishment can be meted out to people who have certain disabilities, considering that they should be punished for crimes they do? Except for the prisons that we have, imprisonment does not look that in the near future to our infrastructure of our prisons will improve. So what alternative punishment can be meted out to them so that they are treated more humanely?
Can we take one or two more questions and then answer?
My question is to Ms. Cecilia. You spoke about attitude of the jail authorities and the doctor towards the accused and the convicts. I want to know, is there any difference in their attitude towards accused of sexual harassment or rape and similar offenses? And what is your take on the, like, there is a large number of students in law school think that accused of sexual harasser who are not convicted should be ostracized, or like they should be boycotted if they don't reform? Or so what's your take on that?
You should appreciate that she does not have the context of answering questions which are apply particularly to this place, but yes.
Anyone else?
Noon. My question is to the panel in general. What I would like to know is that as far as I am aware, that all current efforts to help prisoners of conscience and political prisoners are roughly loose agglomerations, like NHRC looks at certain aspects, Amnesty International looks at certain aspects, PUCL looks at other aspects. Now, what I would like to know is that, for example, there is now this ad hoc committee for the defense of Professor Sai Baba. Are we looking at any kind of permanent panel which would take up such cases which are increasingly likely to arise in the near future, as in the case of the accused in the Bhima Koregaon case and other such cases? Because it's not just about the provisions of the UAPA, but also the state laws which many of these states have in these regard, which are even more draconian and Orwellian. And another question I would like to ask is, has there been any effort made to bring the political movement for repealment of UAPA in line with the civil society's requirements for doing so? Because what we see today is that whenever a civil movement of or a movement for civil rights, economic rights comes in, arises, that particular section of society which is affected by that situation tries to fight the good fight, while the other sections of society sit at the sidelines and simply watch in silence. And what would be the best way in order to make sure that we can bring all of this together? Yeah.
Hello. To answer your question first, Professor Hargopal had mentioned, people are sent to prison for punishment, not for punishment inside. So the question of having a separate set of so-called punishment as such, for me that does not arise, and as such, personally, I believe that this professor had also mentioned that prisons are meant to reform people. But each time my experience has been that more than people inside the prison, It's those who are outside who need reform. And very sadly, most of the time as a society, we stand on a moral and a very self-righteous high ground, believing that, you know, oh, I would never have done that. Yeah. And but we forget that the line is very thin. Tomorrow, anybody can cross that line and you may find yourself behind those bars. Until and unless we have that kind of a change in perspective, you know, this entire attitude of saying that, you know, we are going to, somebody has come in conflict with law, so our solution to that is punishing and imprisonment, irrespective of whether they are able, disabled, whatever category you call them, I really don't see that applying too much. And coming to your question about people accused of sexual offences, yeah, just to tell you, you know, in the context of this entire understanding that we have of crime and of punishment and of the kind of approach that we have towards the accused, yeah, rather than dealing with the issue of sexual harassment there, we very conveniently shut people off, okay? We are not dealing with the reality of what has brought that person there. Say, for example, the kind of gender bias we hold, the kind of patriarchy that our society constantly perpetrates. Without dealing with those issues, you know, you cannot expect to have a separate approach or a separate attitude to people with sexual offenses inside, yeah? And if at all, the kind of, see, if you see in most of the prisons, somebody who has committed a rape, you know, there's a certain kind of a stigmatization that happens by other prisoners. Yeah, that is usually the case. That's usually the case. But what I would also say is that while, see, people spend like 10 years, 14 years, and if we are talking about so-called reform, you know, you'd rather challenge that thought process, you'd rather challenge that mentality. That's the only thing that needs reform. Not, you know, as an individual personality, I don't think. All of us are likely to cross that line and get behind those bars at any given point in time. But unless the reform happens in terms of the attitude, in terms of, you know, the cultural approaches that we have to so many issues, you know, our prisons will continue to be filled. So the next question.
I think there are two things so to add to what she has said. So for example, in Andhra Pradesh, in the combined state, I happened to give lectures to all the jailers and also to some of the constables who work in the jails. At the time, beginning of the lecture, I normally ask their attitudes, and then when you explain the philosophy of the jail, some of the jailers have really changed, and particularly these constables were suddenly got excited. They said, we have a purpose in life. The working in jail, we thought, oh, we are suffering something like imprisonment. And I gave them number of clues. I said, sit with a criminal and then, you know, talk to him and go back and narrate to your children and to wife that why crime is committed, under what condition people commit crime. And then I said that, you know, see, they have committed crime, and that committing crime itself has a social, you know, dimension, that normally a civilized society takes a part of the responsibility for crime. It's not that the criminal is solely responsible for the crime. It all depends how you look at crime and how you look at criminal. And this is more so about the political prisoners. Political prisoners are those who are struggling for transforming the society. Whether you believe in their ideology or not, the very fact that they are concerned with the larger causes, I think that should make us feel and reflect that we have certain responsibility towards such prisoners. You know, so, and as far as Sai Baba is concerned, of course, what a question you raised, there are several civil rights movements which have been fighting in this country. I mean, there are so many organizations in Bombay, in Calcutta, in Hyderabad. Our civil liberties movement, we lost six colleagues of ours. In the struggle of protecting others' rights, six of my colleagues have been killed. So, I mean, there are people who are taking even that much of risk of fighting for the rights. And we had very outstanding lawyers like Kanabiran and Balgopal, who never took any money, but all through life they fought and they got so much of justice. Kanabiran got so many laws I mean, you know, finally he got an encounter, is a culpable homicide, and he has to be booked under murder, charges of murder, and the policeman has to prove under self-defense he fired, and then only, you know, this has to be established. Otherwise, you can't go and pick up somebody and kill, and then you say that it's an encounter, and this judge says Sai Baba is opposed to fake encounter. What else you can do? You would say you support a fake encounter. I mean, you are a lawyer, you are a judge. So I think there are people who are fighting, and all of us who have come to you is also partly to sensitize. Here is a young man sitting here. He was also some sort of my student, if I may claim that way. But I taught, you know, human rights notes to, you know, to the law college, one batch of them. That I think, you know, the law students in a country have a lot. Law students fought for the freedom. Jawaharlal Nehru was a law student, you know, Gandhi was a law student, Patel was a law student, many of them were lawyers, I mean, you know, in the freedom movement. And the lawyers have been fighting for the larger freedoms. And I think the problem with the law university is it's more corporate than, you know, social. And I'm so happy Law and Society brings all of you, and, you know, I mean, arranges this interaction partly to tell you